I'm in the booth, bro. Give me 5 minutes.
The God Box.
I'm here reporting from unrealactivist.com. My name is Brother Tedemos Sankara. We're a Free of All Political Prisoners Liberation Campaign. And we're here at the premiere of Elementary Genocide 3 by my comrade Rahiem Shabazz. Check it out.
Like these crackers got drones, they fly in their saucers. Keep your white Jesus, don't Brady your crosses. They burning our churches, crit pass me the Uzi. I know how to work it, I know how to squirt it. No Martin, no Luther, no King. No marching, no choirs, don't sing. The same Christian lovers that raped their grandmothers and hung their grandfathers.
You know what it is, what it was, and what it could be. This is Rahiem Shabazz. Make sure you check out The Real Activist. Peace and Black Power.
Listeners, don't get. Because they got chains on their brains, and that ain't no diss. Shout out to Tit.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist. Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Thanks for joining us here again at The Real Activist. We're here today with Rahiem Shabazz, the maker of the film Elementary Genocide, Part 1, 2, and 3. Thank you for joining us here today, brother.
Thank you, man. I appreciate you for having me.
Most definitely. We're down here today at the Auburn Research Library here in Atlanta, Georgia. And we want to talk to you a little bit about you using your form of activism in film to talk about the prisoner pipeline situation. Basically how children are tested from the third grade to be able to see who's going to be filling up the prison systems here in America. You've taken this film, this documentary, and you use it as a way of activism and a way to protest a lot of different things going on with black males. What caused you to go down that direction as a form of activism?
Well, I think right now that we live in a curious time, because the moving image is the number one thing that today's youth are gravitating towards, whether it's on social media, Facebook, Instagram. You know, our kids are more prone to watch a documentary and find out the truth than it is to pick up a book. So I think it was ideal for me to do the documentary. And it's more than a documentary. What I like to tell people, it's a call to action, because in each documentary, we spend the last 20 minutes talking about solutions. So this is a solution-based documentary, a call to action. And what I want people to realize is that there's going to be pain, there's going to be suffering, but in the end, you know, we have to respond to our ability, and that's what responsibility means, one who responds to their ability. So we all have ability to get mad, to have pain, to be angry, but what are we going to do after that? You know, so the last 20 minutes of each documentary, we make sure that we have a call to action for our people.
I want to just talk to you a little bit about how you actually got involved with it. I know you work with Daruba Ben Wahad, who's your mentor and somebody you worked with. And he was a part of Panther 21 out of New York, you know, and did some time as one of our political prisoners. Talk to us a little bit about how, you know, your involvement with working with him and working with the youth. What are some of the things you guys got going on now with the youth?
Yeah, right now, definitely, you know, work with a number of elders, including Daruba Ben Wahad, you know what I'm saying? Right now, program-wise, you know, with the youth, we have the Siafu Youth Corps, which is an African scouting program where we're training our youth between the ages of 11 and 17 years old, teach them everything from African martial arts to archery, agriculture. They have their own business. They have a business called Renegade Culture, in which they have their own t-shirt line. We're teaching them basically, you know, character building and putting them on the right side of history, you know. You know, one of the things for brothers like yourself and Rahiem and myself, we kind of grew up in an era where there was still respect for elders. We were reading, we were learning how to be men, you know what I mean? Sisters were learning how to be women. Right now, it's kind of a disconnect with the whole digital divide, so on and so forth, you know what I mean? So we're bringing it back to basics. So we're teaching the youth how to deal with urban survival preparedness, you know what I mean? How do you deal with the police? How do you deal with your elders, so on and so forth? So, you know, we have a real awesome program. We have about 15 youth with us right now, and we're self-funded, and we've just been, you know, moving along right now, you know?
My name is Ed Garnes. I'm the founder of From Afros to Shell Toes. When I'm not sipping sweet tea on Auburn Avenue, I am down with the real activists, and you should be too.
With this whole series that Rahiem is doing, you know, I know he has been through the prison system, and, you know, with you coming through the educational system, him coming through the prison system, and I was talking about somebody like Killer Mike,
who
talks about his mother and her addictions and the type of way the community was focused. Kalonji Jama, Changa and I talked about how Ronald Reagan brought the drugs into the community, and people will say, well, you don't have to do the drugs, but nobody talks about the conditions that are being created to make you want to do drugs, like poverty, you know, homelessness, you know, being denied the opportunity to open up your own businesses in your own community.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things I say when people say black folks destroy their own communities doing riots and different things like that, I'm like, it's not our community.
Wow.
Because when it's your community, the doctors look like you in your community.
All right.
You know, the people who own the grocery store, the people who own the gas station, the people at the bank, they look like you.
Mm-hmm.
They own something. You know, what I mean? They live next door to you. The police, you know, the police department, the fire department, those people come from your community. But with our community, it's so different. We have people from other countries in our community. We have outside invaders, I would say, who shoot us down and kill us like we're not even citizens of this country. Talk about how, as a professor, you got involved with a project like this that covers the dynamics of all of that.
Ooh, well, shout out to my grandmother. You know, my grandmother was my first professor. I had parents that were activists. Like I said in there, my mom, when she retired, she was the second in charge of the whole Atlanta Foot Department Library system. My dad worked in the juvenile court system, so that's where these kind of issues come. He worked in there for over 25 years in juvenile justice. So it comes from their upbringing. But I would say, like, one of my mentors, Dr. Joseph White, who was considered the godfather of black psychology, often said that seeking validation from your oppressor is insanity, right? So once you are seeking that validation, like, we put a lot of time into the physicality of slavery, but not talk about the psychological conditions, right? So if I can make you feel inferior psychologically and I can give you a different value system, everything that we do as far as community building, as far as liberating our people, you have to have the mental stamina and endurance in order to have the behavior necessary in order to liberate folks. So I think we underappreciate, you know, the psychology behind it. And so I've always been an advocate for independent media. If you look at movements for black people, whether it's the Final Call, whether it's the, you know, the work of James Ball and Nikki Giovanni and a host of others, Gwendolyn Brooks, I mean, Rita Dove, I can go on, right? But we always, these people started very independently. They didn't need stamps of approval to get their stuff out. So I think that we have to remember that we can go as high as we want to go.
Right.
But in seeking that validation, like, okay, like, one of my students asked me why I'm not in the forefront, in why I'm not on these television shows. Because when you're a truth teller, you're not gonna get no mainstream approval.
Like,
what they gonna talk to me for?
Right.
I'm liberating black people.
Right.
You don't get prime time for that. And a lot of us have not accepted that, you know, it's a cost for liberation.
Okay, let's talk about the first documentary you did, basically from the school to the prison pipeline. How did you get involved in that, and what is your experience with the prison pipeline for yourself personally?
Well, growing up, I was like many of my peers, where I found myself on the wrong side of the law, and I can speak from experience and from knowledge. I come from a family that was engrossed in generational poverty, and you know, I can say that I was aided and abetted by the school to prison pipeline. At a young age, I found myself behind enemy lines. And when I went to jail, I didn't even have a GED. Within 60 days, I wound up getting my GED. And then when I got sentenced, I wound up going to college. And I graduated at the top 5% of my class 13 days before I got released. But while in prison, I began to notice the stark difference between those that was educated and those that wasn't educated. And then I began to do research, and I found out that 85% of the people that was incarcerated in New York City comes from 8 neighborhoods. So I began to look at these neighborhoods that are crime-ridden. There's inadequate education, health care, and I began to see the disparity between those that live in affluent neighborhoods and those that come from poor communities in the Bronx and Harlem and Brooklyn and Queens. And that's when I started doing the research. And then we found that by the third grade, if you're not reading on level, there's a 75% chance that you're gonna end up in jail. And then what they do is they look at those numbers, and 10 to 15 years, they know how many prisons to build, and they build these prisons and sell them on the stock market. One particular company is called CCA, which is Correction Corporation of America. And if you go to their website, they have on their website, their motto is, if we build it, they will come.
Wow.
And they haven't been wrong yet. But what we have to do is we have to break this generational curse of our kids going to school, and we providing the solution and the formula, because this is something that we don't have to wait on other individuals to do for us. We can do this ourselves.
Talk to us a little bit about how important it is when you talk about these particular films that Rahiem has put together. You're talking about educational system leading to the prison pipeline. When you talk about those different things, how important is it for us to understand that, to know how it winds up to being a situation like a Troy Davis, you know, being accused of something that he was found not guilty of but still executed for?
Right.
What do you speak to that when it comes to us educating our own and telling those stories that we know white America never tell or teach our children?
Education is key, particularly political education, because of the fact that we're talking about, our survival, you know what I mean? And, you know, a lot of folks say they don't get into politics, but the fact is everything's political. The way we talk, the fact that we speak in English right now, you know what I mean? We are a byproduct of an oppressor, you know what I'm saying? And whatever oppressive regime. You can tell when you have a colonized people because of the fact that, you know, you speak a language that is foreign to your native tongue. Mm. You know what I mean? So you get a lot of folks talking about, well, you know, my people wasn't slaves and, you know, I was already here in America and, you know, I came in on a spaceship. And whether you came in on a spaceship or a slave ship, right, you're in the same ship. You know what I'm saying? Ship, so right, that's the reality. So.
And that ship is actually still docked. It's the penitentiary system right
true
now.
True indeed. It's definitely docked. You know what I mean? And in fact, you know, some of the ships are a little bit bigger, you know what I mean? Whether you're in AdMax, whether you're in one of these Supermaxes or whatever, you know what I mean? It's all the same thing. And really, to be honest with you, the world's a prison at this state. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Right now, we are in what we call general population. You know what I'm saying? Because of the fact that, you know, we're monitored every corner, you know what I mean? Police running up on us, dictating, you know, how we move, when we move, the whole nine. You know what I mean? White supremacy is at an all-time high. So education is key. So works like what Rahiem Shabazz is doing and what Richard Shabazz is doing is tantamount, because, you know, it's like what Che Guevara said. Che Guevara said the role of the propagandist is as important as the role of the guerrilla. You know what I mean? So the work you all are doing is propaganda. They're going to, we can fill up an auditorium right now with folks to view a documentary, but if I'm saying, look, let's come out and organize, let's go feed some folks, let's go defend our community, so on and so forth, they're going to look at you like Malcolm would say, like, man, you crazy.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I'm comfortable here. I'm an American. Right. You know what I mean? So once you are properly educated and not trained, you know what I mean, to be a pawn in this system or to become a black aspiring capitalist, because of the fact that we can't be black capitalists. You know what I mean? There's no such thing as a black capitalist, because in capitalism, you have to own the means, the production, so on and so forth. You know what I mean? And we don't own the production. We don't own the wealth. You know what I mean? We produce the wealth. You know what I mean? We fuel the wealth, but we don't own the wealth. You know what I'm saying? We don't own the productivity, the manufacturing, so on and so forth. Mm. You know what I mean? We'll sell some products that were introduced to our community, some African-based products, but then we gotta get them from China or, you know what I mean, Japan or somewhere else. You know what I mean? We're not manufacturing it.
How important do you think it is for us to educate ourselves? To open up our own schools, to be our own teachers.
I think that we have to do that. See, my parents always supplemented my curriculum. They did not allow public school education to change my African-centered self. So while some people was reading Goldilocks and all this stuff, I had Mafario's Beautiful Daughter, my mother read to my brothers. I had Nikki Giovanni spinning soft black songs. So my parents always supplemented my curriculum with something that looked like me. So when I went to college, I thought everybody knew who Nikki Giovanni Giovanni was. I was right, like, what? Right. You don't know Richard, right? Right. How you don't know Gwendolyn Brooks, you know?
Dr. John Henry Clark.
Yeah, I mean, exactly.
From New York, don't even know Dr.
I mean, come on. Yeah, you know, like, so I'm like, yeah. I'm meeting black people that don't know that. And that's the college was the first time. I was like, wow.
Right.
Like, my parents really, like, gave me something. And yeah. So that's how I got into psychology, man, is because I was always interested in the damaging effects of Jim Crow slavery on our mentality. So that's why I became a therapist, man. And so I got into therapy and being a counselor to help black folks. Right. I mean, I help all people, but, you know, my selfish right. needs is to get the
and
mentality.
Psychology is different, too, when you think about yeah. it, because, you know, we are people who... we're dehumanized.
Come on,
there's a difference between mm-hmm. being a slave and being
invalidated.
Exactly. There's a lot that our people have to be recovered from.
Yeah.
You know, I have this conversation sometimes being a part of the hip hop movement and coming out of that
yeah.
that arena. A lot of times, you know, a lot of people in hip hop will say, "Well, poor white people are just the same as." You know, for black people, and I say it's still not the same.
No,
because when you had a 400-year head start and you're still in your situation, well, it's different from me being in my situation.
Look at W.E. Du Bois talked about this in Black Reconstruction, that white folks are always compensated by this psychological wage of whiteness, that even a poor white man is better than a brother because of the psychological wage and benefit package that comes from white supremacy. So, you know.
What do you think about segregation when it comes to us segregating our schools? And allowing white people who were teaching us those at those particular times that we were less than human, they were teaching us that.
Yeah.
What do you say was a mistake or an advantage when our parents allowed them to educate us? Do you think that was?
I think that our parents and their love for us wanted us to integrate because it's the whole. Who's Kool-Aid is sweeter, right?
Right, right.
You know, you don't want to go to the corner store for the wings and get the sweet tea there.
Right,
you
right.
think the sweet tea at Martha's Vineyard or Lenox Mall is better. You know what I'm saying? So that's, you know, they wanted, their intentions were pure in wanting us to integrate. But the thing that happened is that we lost part of our African-centered selves in integrating. So they had the best intentions for us, but the people they sent us to didn't.
One of the things I always talk about with integration, I say the worst thing that ever happened to us was integration. Within integration was us integrating the school system and allowing those who dehumanized us to educate our children. Because I always feel like if people are not gonna, you know, treat you right, they're definitely not gonna educate you right.
Absolutely.
You know, we know that was one of the quotes from the messenger as well. He definitely taught on us educating ourselves. I know with the second documentary you did the Wade versus Brown.
No, it was called the Board of Education Board versus the Board of Incarceration.
Okay.
And in that particular documentary, what we did was we went back to the landmark ruling of Brown versus Board of Education, and we asked the proverbial question, has it done more harm than good? And as you know, it done more harm. Because during that time, 82,000 teachers lost their jobs. So here it is, you integrated the students, but you didn't integrate the teachers. So the teachers that came from our community that looked like us was no longer present in our life. So we was given white European teachers that don't understand the cultural background that we come from. And they was teaching in a Eurocentric way. They wasn't teaching in the Afrocentric way that we are used to being taught. I'll give you one example. Hillary Clinton, she came out with a book, I think it was 1996, and they called It Takes a Village. She used the African proverb, right. It Takes a Village. But the problem is, she's not from our village. And I'll give you something else that a lot of people don't know. The public education and the school system is controlled by whites, and those that are teaching are predominantly female whites, right? 75% are female white, right? 25% of that 75% is married to law enforcement officers. So here it is, you have the white female that mentally miseducates you, and then you have the white male that physically locks you up. So this goes hand in hand. Another thing, the New York State Teachers Retirement Fund is invested in the school to prison pipeline. They invest in private prisons, $17 million.
Speaking of manufacturing products, speak a little bit on how the prisons are being filled up and how people are put to work. Like now, you can get, you know, prescriptions filled for your glasses through the penitentiary system now. Yeah. Companies are doing that. The airlines are using the penitentiary.
Absolutely.
To book, you know, airlines, and they're working on people for like $12 a month.
Oh yeah.
Which is worse than slavery, you know what right. I mean? Worse than the Jim Crow and the black codes and all of that. It's like this system is going unchecked.
Right. Right.
Rahiem talked about how it's on the stock market where people can actually invest in private companies.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Speak
absolutely.
A little bit on that, on just how, you know, powerful it is that they are using people for profit.
Oh yeah, no doubt. And the ill thing about that is the same brothers and sisters that are locked up in the prison right now, you know what I mean, that 2.5 million people that's currently incarcerated in the United States, you know what I mean, the 70%, which happen to be quote unquote people of color, African people, you know what I mean, that are locked up right now, they can't get a job at a Apple or an IBM or Victoria's Secret, but they can make these products inside of the prison. You know what I'm saying? They can't get out and put that on their resume that, look, I worked, you know what I'm saying, I already worked for you, so on and so forth. You know, everything from, like I said, Victoria's Secret to, you know, insurance claims, all kinds of things handled right there in the penitentiary. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So the thing is, it is a, we always talk about modern slavery, that's what it is.
Right.
Slavery never ended, it changed forms.
Right.
You know what I mean? So, you know, present date, you know, yeah, you can get a private prison. If you got enough money, you could build a prison. You know what I mean? And what's happening is these prisons are being built in these rural areas, you know what I mean, where you got these racist crackers who, you know, in hillbillies, so on and so forth, who live in poor areas. And, you know, folks with money come in and bring this prison into their area, build this prison, and they become the workers, the laborers. You know what I mean? So they already have problems with Africans and Mexicans and so on and
right.
so forth,
right.
and folks who are un-American, mm-hmm. you know what I mean, and you know, they handle them mm-hmm. while they're in there, you know what I mean. So these are the folks that live in these towns. These same racist cops, we forget that we're in the state of Georgia, you know what I mean, until we're getting pulled over by one of them.
Right.
We act surprised when the police gun us down, and you know, there's no due process. You know what I mean? There's no one defending it. The first thing that happens is the police unions jump up on TV talking about how innocent Officer Joe Blow is.
Right.
Why? Because of the fact that the police unions are the power behind this slave ship. The police unions are more powerful than the politicians.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because they are the line of defense
right.
for the police chiefs and the mayors, so on and so forth. You know what I mean? So the unions is like the mob and the police is, as they say, the hitters. You know what I'm saying? They the hitmen. You know what I mean? So they deal with you accordingly. You don't have to be intelligent to become a police officer in the United States. You just have to pass a test. You know what I'm saying? You could be someone who was in Iraq or Desert Storm or Afghanistan or whatever. You know what I mean? You coming home from war, you're a war vet, and now you're in these communities or whatever with these insurgents.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So you roll into those communities like an occupied force, and you deal with the inhabitants. You deal with the citizens as if they're foreign troops, when in fact you're the foreign troop.
Right.
You don't want to come into our communities, beat us down, brutalize, terrorize, so on and so forth. Gentrify our community. You know what I mean? Criminalize us, watch the community, you know, put guns and drugs in the community. And oftentimes people will be like, well, you know, the people should know, you know what I'm saying? If they put in drugs and guns in the community, no one's telling them they have to do it. You know, when you're hungry, you'll do all kinds of things.
When the conditions are created as well.
Absolutely.
That make you want to turn to those drugs. It's
yeah.
like people forget about the conditions that are created. Poverty is created first. Joblessness is created. The breaking up of the families is created. All yeah. these things come into effect and play before drugs even get put in the community.
Absolutely.
You know, Ronald Reagan came along and put the drugs in the community, but before Ronald Reagan, we had some situations with other presidents
Absolutely.
That put us in a position to where
yeah.
our communities
yeah.
were
yeah.
being,
yeah.
you know, in a situation where you see like South Africa was, you know, in a
Absolutely.
Apartheid type
right.
situation.
Right.
So
right.
that's mainly what the black community was. And right now you have it being flipped, but we're talking about gentrification now.
Right, right.
So it's
right.
like, you know, now it's not genocide anymore, it's gentrification. So we're gonna add on by adding them back into our community, our population.
Right.
That plays a big part in our schools. And I know with the prison system, when they build prisons in these rural communities like that, that adds on to their population too, allowing them in the when they do the polls for who lives in the community and decide which type of funds are going to go to the community by the population, they also get money and tax breaks off these prisons.
Absolutely.
These communities. Nobody talks about that.
Right.
You know what I mean?
And they count them. They count them on their census.
Right.
Because of the fact that they're now counted as residents.
Right.
And that's why it's important for us. You know what I mean? When the Census Bureau comes around taking that count. You know what I mean? If Joe Blow, your cousin Ted, or whoever, you know what I'm saying, Lil Malik, they locked up. If they still part of that residence, if that's where they live at that point, you count them. You know what I'm saying? Because of the fact that those monies are being allocated, like you said, to these foreign areas.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Where these white folks are that don't give a damn about us. You know what I mean? So, you know, it's a tricky game. You mentioned Ronald Reagan, you know what I'm saying, who was an actor. You know, right now you got the America's built on personalities.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because of the fact that capitalism is a, you know, has to be fueled by a propaganda machine. Mm-hmm. So you have folks like the Obamas and the Trumps, so on and so forth, you know what I mean, who, you know, are charismatic figures.
The front face for
absolutely. Absolutely. You know, a cat like Trump, you know what I'm saying? He's a beautiful character because of the fact that, you know, he reminds us that this is white America.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And this is how we get down.
Right.
And he rolls like an arrogant white man.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because that, you know, like, look, I am entitled, I run things, and we don't care. And you can take your, as he said, you probably got to bleep this, these shithole nations in Africa and Haiti, so on and so forth, what he called us.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? That's what he thought of. He said they were shitholes.
Right.
This is what the president of the United States said.
Right.
You know what I mean? He has no regards for us.
Talk about how you feel about the way they use our people to produce so many products out of the penal system.
You know, oh, man, you know.
Victoria's Secrets,
Changa
about eyeglasses being able to be filled in prescriptions now.
Mm-hmm.
They could do that. I mean, they're filling airline tickets now.
Yeah.
All these different things they're doing in the prison system now. They can't come out and use on their resume.
Yeah.
And they can't get paid enough in the prison to save up any money to where when they get out, they can do anything.
Well, I mean, it's just, I mean, the prison system is just a continuation of slavery. I mean, that's all it is. It's just dressed up. It has, you know, a different kind of flow. But, I mean, at its essence, it's still, you know, slavery. So slavery continues because the people that locked up look like us. The people that's defending the prison and working as guards don't look like us a lot of times. So it's just a continuation of the same system.
So the pipeline exists, the pipeline is real, and we have to fight against that. And one of the ways we do that is by homeschooling our kids or putting them in an Afrocentric school. Malcolm X said, we're the only people that allow our open enemies to educate our kids.
How about that? That's very interesting. Now, I know in the next episode, you do academics with the academia.
Absolutely.
Generation, the whole movement there. Talk to us a little bit about that with part three. Like, how important is it for our people to go, like, we'll hear people say, oh, you know, Obama and Michelle, they went to Howard, Princeton, and they went to Harvard, those different schools. When you look at African Americans, the most successful, over 90% of African Americans who are extremely successful went to HBCUs. They didn't go to Harvard and they didn't go to Princeton, you know what I mean? Like those particular schools. So what do you say when it comes to those academics? Are they helping us or hurting us as a people when they go to those particular schools and come back to our community? What do they do or don't do for our people that's damaging?
I think personally, those that go to America's Ivy League school are not getting the best education. The number one engineers, the number one doctors, the number one lawyers that are African American comes from HBCUs. And we know that in schooling, if you're not being taught to come back and take that education and build in your community, if it just benefits you as an individual and not the community as a whole, then that's not an education. You know, that's indoctrination. And that seems to be the norm for those that go to these schools because they don't teach you about your culture. They don't instill in you the importance of your culture and how to build. And a lot of times, those individuals that go to school they will get positions in corporations and high society, and mainstream, the dominant society will praise them and say, well, this is the first person that graduated from Stanford, or this is the first person that is executive at this prestigious company. But what they're not telling you is that this person has no community ties. This person is not active in pushing his race forward. And then, you know, you begin to take on the oppressor mentality. And we see that with a lot of individuals that go into politics, that come out of these Ivy League schools. They're almost like they're co-conspirators for, you know, the open enemy.
For the open enemy. How about that? When you talk about us educating ourselves, I know Father Hannibal, who was considered the father of African-centered homeschooling, he talked about how it was important for us to make sure that the schools were actually centered in African study, not just being a black school, yeah, quote unquote, but to actually be teaching our children their history and the importance of their history and how to use that to activate their future.
Mm-hmm.
How involved are you with homeschooling, and how do you see yourself in your films playing into that rim and that magnitude of homeschooling and getting this information directly to our children?
Well, one of the things that I've been doing, I've been speaking to a coalition of homeschools where we're trying to find out how we can have it modeled in different states, because everybody has different laws. For instance, I think it's in Utah, if your child is enrolled in a homeschool and you're teaching them, you get a tax incentive. Something like that needs to be modeled in all states. And I think more people will be prone to homeschool their kids. And we know statistically that those that are homeschooled have higher achievement rate academically. So homeschooling is the way, and I'm a big advocate of that. And then another thing, the most important thing for this subject matter, is that there is zero school to prison pipeline when it comes to homeschool. Wow. How about that?
How about that? For joining us here at The Real Activist. Is there anything else you'd like to tell the people about the films and how they can actually purchase the documentaries themselves?
Anybody that's interested in purchasing the documentary, you can go to elementarygenocide.com. And anybody that's interested in speaking with me personally, you can hit me on social media. I'm on Instagram, I'm on Facebook, and I'm on Twitter at Rahiem Shabazz. All right, and on that note, I want to say, in the words of Marcus Garvey, think black, be black, and everything else will work itself out. Peace and black power.
One shot, two shots, three shots, four.